pray and have faith, but also to talk a little bit about you and about what you are doing to mitigate vulnerability. Okay? So, in terms of the special prayer, it's a mercy session, but we do want to talk a little bit about you and your mitigating vulnerability in your life. I've got seven questions for you. So if you can get a piece of paper or electronic tablet and write 1 to 7, you just need to say yes or no. And we'll tell you in advance, I am not going to ask you for your thoughts. Okay? This is personal to you. Only you can decide to take action or not. But I think these are the questions while asking your client, or maybe the questions you should be asking your clients. Okay? So the first question is, do you have a valid and up-to-date will? Okay, do you have a valid and up-to-date will? Yes or no? We don't need any long explanations. Yes or no? Do you have a valid and up-to-date LPA? And I say up-to-date, are your attorneys and other with the trade executives of people. Okay. This is a good one. And why do I ask this question? Because I would never have asked this question before. Because I have just done my own will, this person's will, to meet my wife, and FPS. And I learned some things from that process, but we can certify our own. So, by certifying your home, you can save a lot of money investment if you ever need it or someone else needs it. So, get yourself ready. Have you got yourself ready? So, you've got a copy of a certified secure LPA system. That's a bit like a bonus question because if you said no to the first one, it's worth 2 months. Have you got instructions to access your digital life? So, instructions to access your digital life. I asked this question in a very short poll on LinkedIn, 70% of questions to this. 78% of the people said they have. I think this is probably the biggest problem that people have, because everyone's setting up these online contacts. And in the old days, a paper statement would arrive, and your family would know and so on, all the £50,000 that you get, they know about that. And no one knows. Okay? So, have you got instructions? Anyone who knows me will know I'm obsessed about being hit by a bus. There's also a couple of individuals who I think will be driving the bus. And I'm obsessed about not leaving my wife or either in an awful situation. I've been on a mission for the last couple of years to bring her into understanding what their life is about. Because she's never a problem, she's never interested, nor my kids. The reason why? Because she's a mom. That's your job. My wife calls it a blue kid. But ultimately, do your family, will it be the first time your family are actually has to get involved in contacting because you're an interesting person? Have your next of kin met your financial advisor? Assuming now I'm having a big assumption that you have a financial advisor. It's a bit like what's made us always kind of the wrong time on the right at home. Do you actually do your financial life? Actually, we all need someone. I personally, 4 years ago, 3 years ago, got myself a financial life. I chose someone that trusted When I told that to that stuff on, I told my wife and my children were trust. Because if I was hit by the bus driven by a person, or if I was hit by the bus by that bus, they have to get over that person. You're not choosing that person if you is the thing you have in the generation plan. And the next thing, access your phone. This is a really important one. We do everything by phone. As I left home this morning, I said to my wife, I'm going to ask this question. And she said, well, most people don't trust us. They don't trust anyone with their password or their phone. I do. I know my password. I know my, I know my wife. She knows mine. You've got to trust someone. And actually, pretty much everything is on. The other thing, going back to the question before, was around the digital life. I have an uncle who died 15 years ago, who still is Facebook, still writes to me. Okay. Who is going to turn off your digital life? Who's going to find their bank account and set up and put money in there? Who's going to be able to access your emails if you're hit by that bus? And actually, the biggest problem is not the part of you, but actually still being alive. Everyone else has to deal with you still being alive in incapacitated at some time. So, I think there's one more. Have you shared your wisdom? So, I told my family two things. One is that I wanted to be promoted, which I said I felt my mind a little bit very mad, probably too much now for you, but I want to be promoted, is what I said. I want 50% of my volume to go up in a firework. I want 50% of my volume to be scattered in the Emirates. And I wanted 50% of my volume to go to Parliament, and then take one to go. That's 150 terms now, so it's a little bit extra. So, do people know what you want? The early stuff is in your will. But actually, have you talked about it in depth? I think it was Roald Lundin that wrote a phenomenal book, essentially about having a good life, about preparing and telling people about what you want. Because if you don't tell them what you want, all you're doing is layering extra stress and anxiety on the mental stream. Just say, this has been my mission for the last couple of years. I've been answering something like those 7 questions. I promise I'm not going to ask you what you scored. I think you scored highly. But if you think you scored 7, you've got a little bit of a room for improvement. And I think those are probably the best questions that you can help your clients reduce the vulnerability of their next of kin. And if I've had a conversation about executives and the whole question around what happens when you're taking ongoing advice and your client dies, what do you do? Because the contract is with a deceased. Do you have to recontract with the executives? Do you recontract with the executives? Do you get the executives to confirm that they will allow you to continue to take on their advice at a time when actually they need that advice? So there's a lot of questions there. And I actually said, the answer is that when I die, this would not be the first time my financial advisor meets my executives. Because they're probably my best advisor, they are next to care my family. I hope that my family planner, my family has the confidence in that financial planner, takes my death to the past. If that's actually what I'm being told to do. So, a couple of questions for you to think about yourself and maybe to ask your clients. But for me, this whole question about digital, our digital life, is probably going to become the most challenging one as we go forward. One other thing about this year, due to 109 claims on relative responsibility in the original property tax, but underestimate the impact consumer duty is having on vulnerability. It's massive. It's a massive focus. And Hannah, who is a vulnerability manager, gets up every morning and thinks about what to do, just about how to improve the way we deal with vulnerability. And so our expert team is phenomenal, and we ask them to share the experiences that we've had so far and the team.
What's really important for us here is to think about the circumstances individually, but of course, how they help to one another connect the presence of more of those vulnerabilities that will ultimately push a car into that point of potential harm that we want to get off when we're giving them advice that actually we need to be thinking about people's personal well-being really as much as we do their financial well-being. An example that unfortunately all of us are inevitably going to see eventually is when one of our clients is struggling. And that's a pretty big lump of course. Now we need to be thinking in that. Somebody who's really struggling emotionally to deal with it, to deal with those, the conversations about finances, getting into people's accounts with financial advisors, even with bank accounts, etc., when they're slightly out of our remit. They're really struggling to be able to deal with that. They're going to continue facing a risky position. We need to be mindful of that and how we support them emotionally as much as financially. Of course, naturally, within a couple, within a family, as Eddie said, there's often somebody who takes the lead to that, so we have the lead person across as well. How are we going to support the next individual who's dealing with the financial advisor us, if they've never met that after being part of this conversation previously? And, naturally, some people may turn to having given rather than one to get rather than to try and deal with that, and actually how they take the pressure in terms of their family. So we need to be thinking of that level of that now. What I want to really point out is as much as the FCA asked us to look at these property developments and these specific circumstances that they've given us, is the next step of stonewalling and the cause of the next step of that. So simply because somebody is respected or movement doesn't mean that they can't enter a decision. What we need to be thinking about is that cause of nexus, and that's the point at which we think perhaps this individual is in a position or a place where they should enter into the contract. So, situation about the world, and if we are confident that we can't get the car, at what point is it just a nexus present and do it to the people who are not advising that particular client? Hopefully that makes sense. There's also the FCA guidance. So I just wanted to point out kind of six of the key areas that we talked about, both in the vulnerability guidance and governance and on the number of factors to consider to see what we should start with position of vulnerability, understanding consumer needs, skills and capability, product design, customer service, communications, and regulation. So, without further ado, I'd like to let you guys put the headset on and get going. This session is really about building and talking about everything. And what we're trying to do is through the immersive virtual reality headset that you're going to see, key to view as an experience that may well happen to you, and may well be in some of the clients that's potentially under our advisors, for example, in some way they're advising. And to talk about the evidence, so this session is really quite different from what we've done previously. Once we watch it, I'm just going to very quickly show you how I'm going to get into the whole part of YouTube that you can use. I'm going to ask you four main questions. I really want you guys to join in and feedback to me. If not, a right or wrong answer in some of this, and you're in it because you don't want to answer, but other than that, it's really good to get back to the impact. So you guys might teach me something that I don't want to ask, you'll think about it in different ways. So once you watch it, I'm asking you some questions, if it's extremely prepared, to join in and chat back to this thing. So what I'm going to do is kind of rattle through some of the questions that I would ask financial advisors and give you some of the examples of the answers that I would expect to see. So, what did you notice? I'm hoping that we saw, of course, there's a final place of, let's just hanging around, and it was a clean and untidy. The father's getting quite frustrated, particularly with his phone and his passwords. There was an element, I think, of denial from the daughter, perhaps, that it was not good with him. They talked about a lack of support from the son, so it seems like the daughter's taking it on herself and trying to get her father to be able to get into it again. And the father seemed pretty sad and overwhelmed at the end, particularly about his wife passing away. But what we didn't get to the bottom of was exactly why that happened. So there's a notice, and I think a decision or a discussion that perhaps needs to be had in the future about whether it was grief that this wife has just recently passed away or causes of decline. We then talk about what support we would offer or would recommend. So alluded to some of this, so what understanding is. PAO, I've written there twice. PAO, I think that's a big part of the journey. Apologies. So, understanding any kind of returning arrangements, discussing, of course, the importance of how to return with everybody at any age, to make sure that they're in place with the wisdom of our clients. Understanding next of care and upstate wills, introducing them to a system if necessary, and so incentives like the mortgages are being paid, so that's a commitment to the final census bills, etc. Any third charities or additional support that we can suggest in the contact with, so there is always going to be a point where we need to do a lot of the services. Actually, it's not something for your personal well-being, it's not for your financial well-being, but I can't have that actually rising up kind of really at this point. So it's always good to know who actually could find those things to. Extending their support network in the family and to those charities or organisations, and simplify to make our world of joy and elsewhere, like any sense of it, to take family members to find them. What channel would we recommend? So, honesty and transparency, there's some trust arrangements, trustees and beneficiaries, and making that sort of up to date, and then we can start to access the trustees and beneficiaries, the trust registration service that we've talked about this morning, care provisions and long-term care. More frequent contacts, is an easy thing to put into place to make sure that they're looking after them appropriately. Financial forecasting, policy planning, care services, and documenting and generating support, of course. We did just briefly do a project quite recently with three grants looking at some of the consumer GDP requirements. I'm not going to have to do something today, but what I will do is put something to the slide so that we can have a look at some of the input that we've had from their guys.
So I think the key in terms of vulnerability is getting your heart beating. So, to start with the problem, I know we've always talked about that, to the PAs and things like that, but actually, there's so much you can do to prepare the family for the expected or unexpected. And it's just those second questions that I ask you about yourself, quite powerful, I think, to ask your clients. The other thing I think is quite powerful is to share your own experience. So, as I said to you, I've been on a mission for myself, for my family. It's taken me a long time, it's taken me a long life to take them to get my wills up to date and everything else. And that's just false, and I get in the way of joy. So I think the issue is that there's much you can do as a family, and it comes back to this value of advice. Consumer duty puts an active emphasis on the value of advice. Doing this actually, I think, demonstrates what I know you will do, but actually really brings it to home. I hope that has been worth your while spending time with us. I